Arnie Ferrin's trophies, awards, and honors read like a sports dream menu few people ever get close to achieving. He was a two-time NBA champion with the old Minneapolis Lakers. He led the 1944 University of Utah team to a basketball championship and was named most outstanding player in that tournament. A four-time All-American, athletic director at the University of Utah, and he headed up the NCAA Basketball Selection Committee. He oversaw television network rights contracts worth billions of dollars. So we were excited and honored to sit down with Mr. Arnie Ferrin.
What did you get out of the game of basketball? What do you take away from the game? All these great accomplishments and championships and accolades. And you still, you can tell you love the game. Anytime you're around an arena, you're a bright light. What does the game do for you, Arnie?
Sitting here with you today, having a chance to relive some of the memories that were important to me is what I get out of it. And I'm so surprised that it keeps continuing. You know, you would think 73 years ago that people would even remember what happened 73 years ago. So it's been unique, and I've been blessed to play with good players and have good coaches and have good opportunities to be successful.
Utes strike right back, moving with precision and superb passing. There's one to Ferrin, and he doesn't waste that shot.
In the well-documented run Ferrin and his teammates had in winning the NCAA and NIT titles, there are many stories. One is how the New York sports writers seemed surprised Utah players could even play basketball.
The finesse of their team play and the shooting of All-American Arnie Ferrin. It's the seesawingest battle of the whole tournament.
Basketball was a big item in the state of Utah. And when we got to New York, we were so green, it was hard to believe how green we were, but one of the headlines on one of the papers said, they play basketball in Utah, you know? And so it was kind of fun when we rode home with the trophy to say we play it pretty well, too.
These are the Minneapolis Lakers, champion basketeers.
As a professional, Ferrin had a shoe contract, two new pair of shoes a year. That was it. A deal with the Wheaties Breakfast Cereal Company. All the cereal the family could eat. His salary, just $500 a month. That required a second job, so Ferrin tried his hand at a few business ventures. He thought of the idea of sugarless gum. Wrigley's was just ahead of him. He and a business partner invested in theater on the road. They called it Midwest Attractions.
No, not that.
Signed three pretty darn good comedians, and they were selling out night after night. It was a hit.
Were these morons?
Yeah, but we're organized. Amalgamated Association of Morons, Local 6 and 7/8.
First night we played, sold the house up. Next night we were in North Dakota. It was sold out. I was thinking about retiring. Then the second night it started to snow. And it snowed, and it snowed, and we had 2 weeks of sold-out houses.
All they had to do was get to the next town, but heavy snow had closed the roads. They could still fly out and keep the good times rolling.
He called the vaudevillians together and said, plane will be here in 2 hours, we're gonna fly to the next town, so be ready to fly. Three stooges from Hollywood said, we didn't write a contract, we don't fly. So they stayed there for 4 or 5 days. So I lost all the money.
Enchanted, enraptured, embalmed.
We're honored to introduce you to the University of Utah gymnastics team.
Hello, Mr. President.
There's one more thing you should know about Arnie Ferrin. It's right there on the wall. A photo from more than three decades ago in the White House with President Ronald Reagan.
The President Reagan thing was a highlight for me. And I kept seeing people going into the White House that won. And so I wrote a letter to a friend and said, my women's gymnastics team has won nine national championships. I think it would be appropriate if the President invited them to come and visit him in the White House.
This is Lisa McVeigh.
It happened. The University of Utah women's gymnastics team was invited to the White House. And in the background, right there, was a smiling Arnie Ferrin.
And these are just, I went into National Aerobic Championship in 1995. I won nationals and then I won worlds. And I was the oldest woman to ever win, and that's what I pride myself on. I was 34 and I was a single mom, and that was the best part of that.
Elaine Alfano has a room full of honors, awards, and successes, and many gymnastics championships while at Utah. And yes, she was on that rare visit to the White House.
Looking back, when I was in my 20s, it didn't seem like a big deal. I was so naive and young, but as I'm older, I go, wow, you know, that's a pretty big deal.
Five times in a row. Really is something.
You know, we were a women's gymnastic team, and that never happened back then. And for us as women to have those accomplishments and be invited to the White House, to me now is huge.
As a player, Ferrin knew what it took to be a champion. And away from the game, he learned about the bigger game for all of us.
John Wooden, he's a good friend, and he came to Salt Lake to speak at a gathering at the students. I was so excited to go over and sit down and listen to him tell about how he won all of those championships and which games were most exciting. He didn't mention any of his teams. He talked about building character of people and the benefits of playing basketball, helping them get ready for the rest of their lives. And there's only one John Wooden, isn't there?
And there's only one Arnie Ferrin, isn't there? Who fondly shares the memory of the best time of his sports life.
Nine players living in school, walking on, going to the NCAA tournament and winning it probably is my favorite time.
A favorite time indeed in University of Utah sports history. A real Cinderella story in college basketball. Forever a special moment on the American sports landscape.
I've had a blessed life. I really and truly have.
Arnie Ferrin and the 1944 Utes are one of college basketball's most amazing stories. 71 years ago, they won the NCAA championship. Now, with the war, it was hard to even field a team. Four walk-ons came from within about 40 miles and said they wanted to play. One was Ogden freshman Arnie Ferrin.
I'd been all-state every year in high school, and I really don't believe Coach Peterson knew who I was. I knocked on his door and asked him if I could try out for the team. And as you get older, as I remember, he asked me if I had my own shoes.
This walk-on team couldn't even play at the university. Troops were sleeping in the field house. Arnie and the team couldn't even practice here. In fact, every game was a road game, and they still won. Arnie Ferrin, that kid from Ogden, had his first of four All-American years. And then came the NCAA tournament. Utah was a last-minute replacement. There was an all-night train ride, and a week later, the team that had four freshman starters and only six players that saw action, that Utah team beat powerhouse Dartmouth 42-40. Arnie Ferrin was the most valuable player of the whole tournament. The team without a field house now had a trophy, the NCAA trophy, in a tournament they weren't even supposed to be part of a week earlier. Then the Red Cross saw a chance to really give war-torn America something to cheer about. They made a super championship game, the University of Utah versus NIT champs St. John's. Newsreels around the country flashed the story. Little Utah, without even a home arena, was playing in Madison Square Garden. The amazing story did not end there. Those four freshmen from Utah played their hearts out. Most had never been to the East, and now they were in New York City. At the end of the game, they were victorious. The story that would show on movie screens all over the country. Well, of course, the return to Utah was triumphant.
We had a parade. We had, I think, all the fire engines in the city. We paraded downtown. They closed the school. We brought the parade up in the President's Circle.
So 71 years ago, this very place, a big parade was coming by, led by freshman most valuable player Arnie Ferrin. Now that would be enough of a basketball story, but there's more. For the years at Utah caught the attention of the brand new NBA Pro Basketball League, and the Minneapolis Lakers, which we now know as the Los Angeles Lakers, drafted Arnie. Arnie Ferrin, the kid from Ogden who had to bring his own shoes to try out for the Utah Utes, was now helping the Lakers show that folks would accept the new idea of pro basketball, and making America's first pro basketball dynasty with national coverage and three championships.
1949, again the Lakers were tops.
It was just like at Utah, only here it was Jim Pollard to the legendary George Mikan and to Arnie Ferrin for the layup. Thus, the Lakers won their third title.
The team's terrific, to be specific, is basketball supreme. There's something about that Lakers score that makes a man want more.
64 years after his NBA career, and 15 years after my first on-camera visit with Arnie Ferrin, 90-year-old Arnie Ferrin's life is still surrounded by basketball's greatest tributes. And on top of them all, is his memory of the 1944 Utes, the proudest moment of them all as he looks back today.
If you like sports, that about is about as much fun as you can have. It was an exciting thing to do. It really was fun.
The Utes of 71 years ago. Craigworth, good for Utah.
This is the most valuable player.
With Arnie Ferrin, you have to start with the numbers. These are mythic numbers you just couldn't make up.
It's an unusual distinction.
A rare four-year All-America at Utah, he led the Utes to the 1944 NCAA championship and became the first of only three freshmen ever named tournament most valuable player.
We were the only team in 1944 that started four freshmen that ever won the NCAA championship, which I think is fun. Yeah.
That year, Arnie's Utes actually went to New York to play in the National Invitation Tournament, but lost in the first round. The Utes were then asked to replace Arkansas in the NCAA tournament after a car wreck injured two Razorback players. The Utes played and won, then got a second chance at the NIT winner in a special Red Cross benefit game.
So we got to win the NCAA championship and then play the winner of the team that in the tournament that we had lost in, and we did beat them too, so we felt like that maybe that was pretty good.
Finally of age, military service interrupted his college, but Arnie came back to Utah to play on the 1947 NIT championship team. He was again drafted, this time by the Lakers.
The Lakers. We don't say Minneapolis in my house. We just say Lakers.
Arnie led the Lakers to a pair of NBA titles. Well, he did get a little help from a center named Mikan.
I told you, he and I led the league 1 year in scoring for roommates. We don't divide who made most of the points.
Three tournaments, four titles, another rarity.
As Tom Golis says that there are only two of us that have played on an NCAA championship team, an NIT championship team, and an NBA championship team.
Arnie then traded his sneakers for golf spikes.
And I could have won the state amateur championship twice, except I met better players.
Yeah, well, there is that.
Arnie came back to basketball as general manager of the Utah Stars.
Drafted Moses Malone.
He became Utah athletic director, chaired the NCAA basketball tournament selection committee, where his Utes were on the bubble. And Coach Archibald wasn't happy when Arnie couldn't get them into the tournament. But in an age when even the most revered sports heroes are tainted by scandal, the watchword of Arnie's career?
Integrity. He is Mr. Integrity.
Bill Child has known Arnie for 40 years.
Oh, I don't know of anyone that has a better life and a better resume and proven himself to be a model, to be a real pioneer of progress.
And I suspect part of the reason that I'm getting this award is I had a 13-year-old great-grandmother who drove a wagon across the plains. And it is pioneers in athletics.
Those pioneer genes led to one of the most incredible sports careers in America.
The pioneers brought that spirit of having athleticism and competition, and so it really was fun.
In basketball, in business, or life, when things really matter, Arnie Ferrin can still make his shots.
The 100 greatest moments in Utah basketball history. Utes in the Big Apple. In 1947, the National Collegiate Basketball Champion was crowned in Madison Square Garden.
We're in Madison Square Garden in New York City. In cooperation with the University of Utah, is mighty happy to bring you that exclusive play-by-play account of the finals in the 10th Invitational Basketball Tournament between the Utes of the University of Utah and the University of Kentucky.
The highly favored Wildcats were number one seed in the NIT, the Utes the number eight seed, and had won their first game with Duquesne by only 1 point. Their second with West Virginia by two, while Kentucky had breezed to the final game. But the Blitzkids from the West were the New York crowd favorite. Coach Vadel Peterson used only six players: Leon Watson, Vern Gardner, Watt Masaka, Arnie Ferrin, Fred Widener, and Lyman Clark.
Down together, and it's thrown away by Masaka. Here's Masaka on a quick break, dribbles down, but once he gets into Utah territory, he stops, holds it up, waits for Ferrin. Here's Ferrin's push shot in.
While Ferrin and Big Vern shared offensive chores, it was the defensive play of Watt Masaka that captivated the crowd. Watt held Kentucky's leading scorer, Ralph Beard, to just 1 point as Utah won by four, 49-45. Vern Gardner, the MVP, and the Big Apple belonged to the Utes. Madison Square Garden, 1944, the NCAA championship game. Utah in the light jerseys versus Dartmouth. 89-year-old Arnie Ferrin remembers it like it was yesterday.
It's surprising, as you get my age, how many things you forget, but I don't forget this.
And how could you?
Arnie, number 22, with his 22 points, earned the MVP trophy.
It has a bumper two in it, and I have a bumper two in my head to match it.
The Utes National Championship story 70 years ago is like a Hollywood script. The young Utes, most of them right out of high school, had just lost in the NIT. But after the tragic death of an Arkansas player in a car crash, things would change.
A phone call came saying, would you come and take Arkansas's place in the NCAA tournament?
They beat two teams to make it to the championship game against Dartmouth, which turned out to be a game that defined March Madness.
This was the first overtime game in the March Madness history.
Utah won 42-40 before a crowd of 15,000 people. Then came home to a huge celebration. The Utes have not repeated an NCAA championship yet. The closest they came was Rick Majerus' 1998 team that lost to Kentucky in the title game. For Arnie Ferrin, that game in 1944 changed his life forever. His jersey retired in the rafters of the Huntsman Center. At home, his office is a time machine. Arnie still has the 1944 championship game program, a room stacked full of awards, and photos of his two NBA championships with the Minneapolis Lakers. So how does Arnie's 1944 team stack up to today's college basketball?
The world we were in, we were a pretty good basketball team.
With this stunning view of the Huntsman Center from his balcony, Arnie hopes one day his beloved Utes will make basketball history again.
Cloistered halls of the University of Utah nearing its 100th anniversary year. Seems like an out-of-the-way spot to Hundlas. Never mind those co-ed fellas, I'm not talking about them. We're strictly concerned with the world of sport. And this is Bill Stern taking you over to the gymnasium where the athletes hang out. Here's one of the finest, best-equipped buildings devoted to indoor sports in the entire nation. But let's not stand here staring at it. Rather, let's continue the search for our Cinderellas inside and... here they are, Coach Battle Peterson's Utah Basketball Brigade. Hardly rated a chance even in their own Big Seven conference, the Utes started quietly perfecting the fundamentals of the game. Peterson doesn't believe in wasting shots and spend plenty of time on shooting practice. With accent on the layup, he believes every man should lay up a few shots for a rainy day. Team that's turned out to be one of the most colorful in the land. They have a number of nicknames. The Redskins, which is official, the Blitz Kids, the Cinderella Cagers, and from the Bobby Sox Brigade, Cute Utes. Looks like old rocking chairs got them, but it's just the Peterson system of practicing getting rid of that ball. Volley passing or tip tossing it's called. And you'll notice they stress accuracy rather than speed. The sitting position keeps them from putting body English behind the pass. Idea is to use fingertips, wrist and arms rather than weight. Comes next foul shooting. Here the Utes are at their best. Now let's meet these cagey characters close up. Introducing Arnie Ferrin, highest scoring guard in collegiate ranks and playmaker deluxe of the Utah aggregation. All-American center, Vern Gardner, voted best all-around player at the National Invitational Tourney in New York. He's a dead shot with either hand tied behind him. Forward, Leon Watson, a ball hawk who's on top of every play. He throws few shots away. Leon's light, but a shifty, swifty. Fred Widener, a real team player on both offense and defense. A guard who has to be guarded from any spot on the court. He's a hot shot. Wat Misaka, midget of the squad, one of the finest ball rustlers and floor players in the business. A Japanese-American, he served in the Pacific in Army Intelligence, and that's the key to the kind of basketball he plays, intelligent. Lyman Clark, workhorse of the Utah squad who plays either guard or forward. A dangerous Dan, his specialty is the long high looper, they call him Lyman the Skyman. Dick Smoon, guard, a first-class play breaker-upper and a set shot artist who's known around the Rocky Mountain Loop as Tricky Dick. Ferrin starting the play. Watch that deceptive backhand pass to Misaka. There it goes to Gardner, who just taps it over to Widener. Fred's bet is the one-hand set, a sort of shot put. Swish. The Utes started out the season like Cinderella, practically orphans, but where the gal in the fairy tale had a pumpkin for a cook, pumpkin around and make a pie out of it from any old position. Working it through the defense is the Utes fort. Watch Ferrin set up this play with a backward overhead lob to Smoon, and the rest is regular routine. Swish! Outside the defense, it's Ferrin handling that ball. There's some of that backhanded business to Gardner. He gets rid of it quick to Clark. What makes this outfit click is not individual stars, but that old team play. The Redskins get away to a slow start in the regular conference season. They just hadn't learned to pull together. Their timing wasn't quite perfect. Then the combination of Masaka now handling the ball to Leon Watson taking the pass put out the Utah Bear. It's one thing to be good on the practice floor, quite another to rack them up against major competition. And I don't mind telling you, the opponents on their schedule didn't worry much about the team that was rated just a shade better than fair to Midland. We've given their special stuff the once over lightly. Now let's see how it clicks when the Redskins of the Rockies go on the basketball warpath. It's the night of the ball for our Cinderellas, the National Invitation Tournament in New York. The dark-shirted, roaring Wildcats of the University of Kentucky are overwhelming favorites. Colorful Kentuckians carry the attack to the Utah goal. Utes strike right back, moving with precision and superb passing. There's one to Ferrin, and he doesn't waste that shot. Crowding that Wildcat goal, playing a cool, well-paced game that pays off at the cashier's cage. Looks bad for Kentucky. One of the few times in the season the Wildcats have trailed. They're no pushovers and stay right in there fighting, but they're missing shots. Gardner comes up with it, moves to the Kentucky defense zone. There's a perfect pass to Ferrin, and Arnie hooks it in. Something for Utah backers to howl about. With seconds to go and trailing by 4 points, Kentucky tries desperately to stay in the game, but it's all over. The Redskins are the nation's rage in a cage. Utah's great team and their coach, truly the Cinderella team of basketball.
It's Minneapolis ball. Schaefer passes to Mikan in the pivot, and the big center dribbles in and scores. There's the pass to Schaefer, and George Mikan hits with a tap-in as Schaefer misses the mark. On a pass from Pollard, Mikan feints Nichols out of position and lets it go. It's no good. Mikan recovers, and he scores as the Lakers go on to take the series 4-2 to become the champions.
While denying it to Arkansas,
Allied forces overseas continue to stand up to the Imperial Army's might. Under General Douglas MacArthur's command, our troops continue to make grand advances in the Philippines. From everyone back home, go get them, boys! Here in the States, the annual National Invitational Basketball Tournament tipped off in New York City. The University of Kentucky stuck by the University of Utah in the opening round at Madison Square Garden. But everyone took notice that the Whiz Kids from Utah put up a pretty good scrap.
Oh yeah, we followed it. We followed to see what was going on.
What a time it was, and what a time it was, it was. A time of innocence, a time of confidences.
But Utah's 1944 basketball story would continue. A tragedy took place in Arkansas that would dramatically alter Utah's basketball plans and would forever change my life. Their story and my story are very different. And as you are about to find out, they're the same.
An automobile tragedy forces the University of Arkansas to withdraw from the NCAA basketball tournament. The University of Utah will replace them in Kansas City.
We didn't get all the details, just that there had been an accident and they couldn't play, and could we go in and substitute for them. It wasn't until later that we heard that there was a death.
Coach Lambert wanted to have a practice game, and after we finished, the coach told us to go on home.
And on the way back, while we had a flat tire in the Ozarks, raining, and the shoulders were muddy. We had to stay on the pavement to change it. This was the old wooden body Ford station wagon. And we had already gotten the spare back on the wheel, and Dino Nichols and Ben Jones and Everett Norris, assistant coach, were putting the flat back on the back of the station wagon.
When these lights came flashing over the mountain road, yeah, boy, I said, uh-oh, we're in trouble.
The guy just pinned the three of them between the station wagon and his car. And he was a undertaker from Rogers, Arkansas. Gardino lost one leg. And Ben had compound fractures of both legs. We had to pick him up, three of us had to pick him up when he put him in the station wagon because his legs just dangled.
And of course, Norris,
heck of a nice guy.
So they said, well, would it be all right if we just went ahead and selected the next runner-up?
The coach had gotten a notice from, I guess, the NCAA that Arkansas had this problem. And they wanted us to fill in, and he wanted to know if we wanted to or if we wanted to just go back home. And boy, to a man, we wanted another chance.
Utah, we said, they're not going to win this state.
After losing in the NIT, Utah's turned into the sports world Cinderella darlings by knocking off Iowa and Missouri in the NCAA tournament, and now head back to the Big Apple for the championship.
The nine of us who played on the team all lived within 30 miles of the university, and none of us were recruited, and none of us were on scholarship.
We're just all friends, you know, a bunch of country boys is all we were, you know.
We knew that some of us were going to be going in the service, and so we almost thought, well, you know, this is our one chance. If we blow this, we'll never get a chance again.
New York City was the site of the 1944 championship game between Utah and Dartmouth.
It was real close, you know, 2 or 3 points separating us. They'd go ahead, and we'd go ahead, and then right at the end, we were ahead 2 points, 3 seconds to go, and McGuire shot a left-handed shot almost from the center of the floor. It was just a huge shot.
Had no business taking it, had no business going in, and it did put us in overtime.
This young Utah team already played.
In the overtime, there were about 5 seconds to go, and I was over there free, so he threw it to me, and I shot it. It hit the rim and rolled around and finally rolled in. It wasn't a swisher.
I got the paper to see if they won it, and they did. Said, boy, this was great. Said, now what's going to happen? Said, now we're going to have to share the championship. But we didn't.
I've many times wished that we were able to meet them, but we never have.
I think the play on life is so interesting because they didn't get to. Go. Some of them, I think, some of them had depression. I think one committed suicide and one lost a leg. And I think the fact that we had that opportunity really has impacted our lives.
Their plight really made for a lot of happy moments for us.
You know, it's something that you'll never forget.
It could have been us, but wasn't to be.
60 years ago this month, we began this journey. Once again, we all celebrate Utah's Cinderella story, but now you finally have the chance to hear mine.
Utah was later given the opportunity to face St. John's, that year's NIT champion, in a game played for charity. Utah won that one, too. Coming up next, Clark's conversation with a pair of Husky heroes, Emeka Okafor.
Hello there. I'm Arnie Ferrin from Utah's 1944 NCAA championship team.
And I'm Wabi Saka, also on that winning team. The Marriott Library has been documenting Utah basketball since its earliest days,
including our history-making team that won the NCAA tournament.
We invite you to come take a look.
Boy, those were the days.
Yeah, remember when we could jump?